Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to investigate the measurements of inrush current. Now, I started looking into doing the review of the HT Instruments 9022 clamp meter. It's a nice little clamp meter. It does both AC and DC, and it does inrush current measurement. And that sent me down a little rabbit hole, because even they said to me, trying to get inrush current measurements done correctly can be a challenge. And as I started looking into this, I realized it was quite a challenge and I had to learn a fair bit myself. Now, what we're going to do in this video, we're going to cover off doing measurements on an oscilloscope. We'll talk about, in particular, where inrush current measurement is perhaps most useful is understanding circuit breakers, where they can run at a certain constant current, and then they have an instantaneous breaking where they use either thermal or an electromagnetic switch to switch out short circuits or peak inrush. And these can be affected if you've got a motor starting up. There can be a surge of current which will trip these. And that's where being able to take the correct measurements and then understanding what circuit breaker you require can be critical. But as I discovered, there's a few challenges. Now, for one, I just want to note up front, I'm doing this video, I've done as much research as I can. I've had very helpful input from HT Instruments. I've had helpful input from Mike at Agilent to help me understand how to do the measurements on the oscilloscope and get those correct, because there's a few gotchas there I'm going to show you if you try this yourself. I do have an outstanding query with Fluke in the way their meters measure this, because I think that's where the challenge can be. And if this starts a conversation and perhaps a bit more enlightenment on this topic, then it's great. But I'll show you what I've discovered. So we'll start off by talking about the basic circuit breaker. We're going to talk about its key attributes, and then obviously the challenge with trying to take measurements to understand your requirements perhaps in a circuit breaker. This video isn't going to be too in-depth, it's going to be an overview. I hope to follow up in time with a second video where we actually open one of these up, I show you inside, and we'll do some practical demonstrations where I do a test where it's overloaded, and then one where it is tripped with an instantaneous peak current, and then to see if we can take the correct measurements from that. Your general circuit breaker that you might have in your breaker box or your DB board serves several functions. There's probably four key functions, and again, you get different types of breakers, so I don't want to generalize. But with a breaker like this, you'll see it's got a switch on the front, which can be switch on a circuit and then switch it off. It'll have a rating on the switch, generally speaking. This one happens to be a 20 amp breaker, and that's a 20 amp RMS, and that's going to be important as we get into this discussion. So it can make or break a circuit. It acts as a switch. It can act as an overload protection. So if you've got this rated for 20 amps and your circuit starts drawing 22, 23 amps, it can then be set to trip to protect the equipment and wiring. So that's its other function. It will also then have an electromagnetic. So that first part where you're trying to handle a constant load is handled with a bimetal strip in here. And as that bimetal strip starts carrying more current and starts heating, it starts to bend, and that triggers the trip. Or if you get a huge overload, so if you get a short circuit, you could have 100 to 1,000 times the current rating flowing through your equipment and your wiring, and you want to stop that very quickly. And that's where it has an electromagnetic solenoid inside. So coils wrapped around, which can energize a little plunger. And when it gets that really high peak current, it can click in and also trigger the trip. The other functionality that it does have, so those are three key things already, the switching, the overload, and the short circuit protection. It then does also arc dissipation. So when you're trying to cut off the flow of energy, you've got some contactors inside your circuit breaker. And even as those start coming apart, you can get an arc when you've got high current and particularly high voltage. You can get an arc which continues the current flow. So that's the one risk. The current flow continues for a longer period of time. And that arc can cause ionizing of the air inside. And if it's really bad, it can damage the circuit breaker or cause it to explode. So they have arc dissipation built into these as well. They have like a space where the contacts grow in size to increase the length that the arc has to travel to get that to dissipate. They also have plates inside with some insulation, which also dissipate the arc and extinguish it as quickly as possible. So there's a fair bit that goes into these, and it's worthwhile noting, it's worthwhile paying for name brands which have got the correct ratings and have been tested, because there are copies which don't provide any of that protection. Now again, the one thing I want to highlight, and then we're going to do this in a future video, is understanding safety and what these various safety devices can do. A circuit breaker like this one is not designed to save a human life. The amount of time that a high current can flow before this reacts will be far greater than the human heart can withstand, or your body. For those, you need proper earth leakage devices, because they need to switch off instantaneously when you get, let's say, a difference in 6 milliamp of current to prevent anything going wrong. These, as I've noted, let's say you've got this one which is rated for 20 amps, you could have 21, 22 amps flowing through here for a number of seconds, even a couple of minutes, before eventually it activates. These will typically, in their spec or data sheets, have a graph which shows you, for the amount of current, how quickly it's going to react. And then they'll have a separate graph which will show you how quickly and instantaneously it will react when it gets a high short inrush current, a high quick peak, or a short circuit. And even though those might be noted in the data sheet, ambient temperature and a lot of other qualities and the way these are made can affect those specifications. So let's get down to then the challenge that I faced in terms of measurement. In particular, if you have one of these that you've got connected up, and I'm going to quote some figures because it relates to the motor and the startup currents that I've got behind me. The motor behind me, for the most part, when we run it, it's an AC motor, will draw 4 amp, depending on where you've got it set at. It's got a VFD, so it's got a variable frequency drive to control the speed and how it starts up. That induces its own problems because it causes harmonics and distortion of the waveform. Now, when you start up the motor, there's going to be an inrush of current because you've got to energize the coils around the rotor. You've got an inertial mass to start up. So there can be this inrush current, which can be anywhere from 4 to 10 times the running current. So if I've got a circuit breaker that's rated for 6 amps, I've got wiring that caters for, let's say, 5 amps, and the breaker is sitting at 6 amps. If the inrush current is too high, it will trip this with a high instantaneous current, or that inrush current. Now, the challenge that I came across is that many of the test equipment, for one, and I'm going to demonstrate, struggles to get that proper inrush current measurement. Some of the tools will measure the inrush current. They'll do a good job at capturing the waveform. In particular, some of the Fluke tools that I've got will do that, but they display the reading as a peak. Now, from what I can see, and this is where I'm intrigued to get feedback, most of the measurements on the data sheets for these devices are in RMS, so a DC equivalent, an RMS rating. Certainly for the constant load that these are supposed to carry, like the 20 amps, that's RMS. But even for the peak instantaneous reading, which can be literally only 1 or 2 cycles, that is also RMS. And if your meter is giving you a peak reading of a distorted waveform, it's very difficult. You cannot do a straightforward calculation to get that back to an RMS reading. And that's where the challenge comes in. So I'm just going to show you, take you over to the board just to show you that, and then we'll do some practical demonstrations on the oscilloscope and with some of these meters. If we take a look at these waveforms on the board, we can see on the top here, I've got one which is a fairly nice, clean sinusoidal waveform. And in this case, it's a current waveform, and it could be current which is constantly running something like an incandescent light. So there's no power quality issues, there's no distortion, so it's a nice, clean waveform. If you want to understand the RMS, or the kind of DC equivalent, so your RMS calculation is going to give you the equivalent DC power dissipation, and that's what RMS gives us. Now, to get the RMS of a pure sine wave, you just take the peak of the wave and you multiply that by root mean square, so which is going to give you 0.7071 times your peak, and that gives you RMS. Now, you'll know that many multimeters will say they are true RMS, and that's because a normal multimeter which does, let's say, averaging and isn't true RMS, it will be able to work with a pure sinusoidal wave. But once you get a distorted waveform, that's when the challenge comes in, and that's where true RMS calculations are able to deal with a distorted waveform. Now, if we come down and have a look, so down here, I've got a distorted waveform, and you'll see the same waveform is being generated by that VFD, which is controlling the motor. So as opposed to having, if we've got a period over here, which starts over here and ends over here, we've got these silly little humps, which are going because we've got harmonics, which have caused distortion. And once you've got that situation, you can't just take a peak reading and then derive an RMS value because you've got the distortion. And that's where I find the challenge comes in with some of these meters. And I'm going to show you this on the Fluke. The Fluke does a good job at capturing inrush current. Your meters which do inrush current measurement really need to take multiple readings of a cycle that's coming in to capture all the information to then do a correct analysis and provide you with a reading. But some of these meters, like some of the Flukes I have, will just give you a peak reading. And you cannot deduce from a peak reading on a distorted waveform what your RMS value is going to be. So that's where I say I've got a query out to Fluke to understand, can they provide an RMS reading, or why they only provide a peak, so that I'm better informed when I'm testing these tools. When we get to the oscilloscope, and the reason I've got this up on here is when you're trying to verify these readings that, let's say, a meter like the HT Instruments 9022 is giving, you need to be very careful how you take that measurement on the oscilloscope. It's very easy, if you don't frame your cycle or your waveform correctly, to not get a complete period. When it's doing the measurement and it's got the measurement tools to do RMS for AC waveforms, if you do not correctly get the right waveform in for where it's taking the measurement, it's not going to have the right amount of information to give you a correct reading. And that's the one catch. If I just took the reading between the two humps, thinking that that was my full cycle, I would not get the right reading. I have to capture a proper full period. So we've got a period which I've drawn down from the top waveform. You've quite clearly got on a pure sine wave with no distortion. It intersects the zero line at a certain point, and that'll be the start of the period. It crosses and then comes back up, and that's the end of the period. But you don't have that with a distorted waveform. So you need to try and establish what that is if you're going to get a correct reading. So let's go over to the bench and see that in practice.
I'll give you a quick run through of the bench and the setup before we actually start doing the testing. For this first bit of testing, what I'm going to do, I'm using my Siglent signal generator to generate a pure sine wave with some caveats, because I know that probably there are some offsets on there which could disrupt the measurement, but it's good enough to show for this exercise. I'm using the Agilent DSO X2000 oscilloscope, where we're going to look at the AC RMS measurement. On the bench, once we start doing the inrush current measurements, we're going to be using certain clamps. I'll come back to those. We're going to be testing some clamps side by side to see how well they measure. And then for the to generate the inrush, I've got this AC motor with a variable frequency drive, which will generate the harmonics and show the complication with these measurements. Coming back to the clamps, I initially, when I started this exercise, was using a Fluke i400S. It's a purely AC clamp. The potential issue with doing that is that with inrush current, you can have a DC offset, which can affect the measurement. And a purely AC clamp is not going to measure that. So fortunately, some time ago when I invested in my Fluke 43B, I also invested in a Fluke Hall effect or DC clamp meter, which can do both AC and DC. And that at least will provide a more accurate reading from the wire through to the oscilloscope and through to the 43B, because the measurement will go through the 43B and also be picked up by the oscilloscope so we can make the comparative measurements. So the first thing we're going to start off by working with a good pure sinusoidal wave, which I've got coming in from the signal generator. I will just note what I have done, which is handy. A lot of oscilloscopes allow you to do this. I've gone and set the ratio of the signal so that it works perfectly with the clamp that I've got, which, if I remember correctly, is 10 millivolts per amp is being displayed on the vertical scale. I've also gone and set the measurement as opposed to volts, which would be the normal reading. I've just gone and set it to amps, just so it's more easy to decipher what's going on. We're going to take a look at the sine wave. Now, the measurements, the three measurements that I've got up here, for one is a peak-to-peak reading from the top to the bottom of the waveform. Then I've got an AC RMS FS measurement. And that is an AC RMS full screen or full scale. So it is taking the RMS measurement of whatever it's got in the display. And that can become a challenge, and I'll show you why. That was to do with the period. If you don't have the right period that you're kind of looking to measure in the display, that's going to give you an incorrect reading. It's giving you the correct measurement for what you've got in there, but perhaps not what you quite want. Then you get AC RMS cycle. Now that's very helpful because it'll actually give you a reading for the number of, a certain number of cycles, which is what you're after, but it requires three edges to do that. And when you're coming down and you're looking at inrush current and you only perhaps got a single period and you haven't got enough edges, well then you're not going to get a reading there. And those are the challenges I just want to show you that you can have on an oscilloscope. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to pull in just to demonstrate that. I'm pulling in so that we've got more than one period in the display of the scope. And you'll see this is where you get those differences. Here it's showing that the AC RMS value is 10.48 and the AC RMS for the cycle of the edges it's getting is 10.69. So there again shows you where you can have a difference if you after a particular reading, and understanding how these two readings work can then at least help you avoid making the mistakes that I was initially making. If we change the time base and go in a little closer, you'll see that then the AC RMS cycle does not have enough edges to give you a measurement. So that's the challenge there. So I'm gonna come out to where we can get a reading. That's just over there. And now what I'm gonna do, because we've got this clean waveform, I want to see whether doing the calculation on a calculator, doing a normal RMS calculation, gives us about the right reading that we're getting on the Agilent. Now bear in mind that oscilloscopes still aren't the best at getting accurate voltage readings on the vertical scale. So it's got a peak to peak reading of 30.4 amps. So I'm going to put that in. Now bear in mind that to get an RMS, it's a peak, not the peak to peak. So we have to divide that by 2. We get 15.2 amp. Then we multiply that by 0.7071 equals 10.74. And if we have a look at our AC RMS, which is the better one to look at because we've got more than one period in the screen. So this, for this measurement now, this will probably give us the best. That's giving us close to 10.7, so not far off our actual calculation. So in this scenario, if you had a pure sinusoidal wave and let's say a meter that you're using to measure, let's say I was using a Fluke meter and you had a wave which didn't have distortion on it, you could use that calculation to work out what your RMS value is. Of course, ultimately when you've got your meter, you're not looking to pick up a calculator and try and work things out. You'd like your meter to give you the reading that you're after. And that's why I'm going through this exercise. What I want to show you now is if we go down and I go into the point where we no longer have an AC RMS reading and the AC RMS full scale or full screen is doing the calculation. If I move that waveform, I'm going to do a run stop. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to come back out. I'm going to do a run stop just so that I've got enough waveforms. Go back in. And if I move that waveform, what we're expecting to see, because this is doing its calculation across here, it can potentially change as I move the waveform through the screen. But if you take a careful look, you'll see it's not altering too much. 10.57, 10.56, 10.8, there's a slight difference there. Those differences I would account for, there might be a DC offset or an issue from my signal generator. But for the most part, because we've got a clean waveform, it's got a good period, that reading doesn't change too much. Now what we're going to capture, I'm going to capture a waveform from the AC motor running where we've got some distortion, and we'll see what happens. For this exercise, I'll just quickly explain what I'm doing because I won't be able to capture it all in one frame of the camera. I've now got the Hall effect, or the DC clamp of the Fluke, switched on. So it is reading the AC coming in, which is there ready to power the AC motor. If you look on the screen already, you can see those little ripples or bumps. And that's because already just having the VFD powered up is sending a little bit of distortion and noise onto the AC power line. Now, the way I've got this VFD set up at the moment, you can configure this to do soft starts for exactly the reason to avoid trip switches or overloading circuitry. But I've got this set up to kind of start the motor immediately, as I would as if it was just directly plugged in, because we want to get a nice inrush current. So I'm going to fire this up. I'll just demonstrate as I push here. When I fire this up, so it's the quick startup and a slow rundown that it's set up for. On the scope, I'll just change the scale. There we go. That is the distorted waveform that we're now going to take a look at. Here is that captured distorted waveform, current waveform that we've got that was feeding the motor. At this point in time, this would be its kind of constant low. There's no inrush here. And something that I'm about to demonstrate here will be exacerbated once we get to see the inrush current, and you don't have a kind of more repetitive waveform. When you've got that inrush, your waveform, you don't have kind of consistent repeating waveforms, you get a change in the waveform, and that adds a challenge when you're doing these measurements. So as I start to change the time base and kind of come into the waveform, you'll start to get this disparity between the two. They're not too far off, the AC RMS full scale and the AC RMS cycle. But when you're wanting to take a peak measurement, as I said, you probably only have one period or two periods, but for the most part, one peak period that you want to get your reading for. And once you start zooming in to do that, you don't have enough edges to get your AC RMS cycle, which would have given you a fairly accurate reading because it's taking into account the period. Now we are reliant on the AC RMS full scale, which isn't taking period into account. It's doing it just what you've got displayed full screen. So let me just show you the challenges. You'll see as I go in how this number can potentially change. If I move the signal so that we've only got that one part of the distorted cycle, you can see that it's giving me a reading of 2.9 amps. Whereas if I move things along, that reading is going to change 3.5 all the way up to 4.4. So that is the challenge that you face now that you're trying to take readings or measurements from a distorted waveform in a manner like this. So let's just go back to trying to do that calculation, because as I noted, the challenge is that you're going to get this peak-to-peak reading from the tool. And if you're wanting to correlate that to an RMS reading to compare it to something on a data sheet, you're going to find it's a challenge. So let's go through the exercise again. We've got 22 amp as our peak to peak. We're going to divide that by 2, simple calculation, it's 11. Now we're going to multiply that by 0.7071 to hopefully give us our RMS value. And look at that. They are vastly different. And the reason, as we can see, because we haven't got that pure, nice, big sinusoidal waveform, you're going to have less real current or power dissipation, equivalent DC power dissipation, RMS, than you would if it was a pure, undistorted sine waveform. So 7.7 versus what it's really calculating here of 4.4. Now the challenge is, when we get down to looking at inrush current,
How do I know when I've got enough or the correct period in the screen? So there's another tool that you can use. And what we're going to do first now is capture an inrush with several tools and then compare the measurements versus what we get on the oscilloscope. On the Fluke 43B, I'm going to go into the inrush current setting, and the inrush time that it'll measure is 5 seconds. I push enter. It's now sitting there ready, waiting for it to trigger on some inrush. I've got the HT Instruments HT9022. I've got it set ready for the correct frequency. It's also got, I'll explain in review about the fixed, but it's set its trigger point at 5 amp. All I need to do is push the run. And it is now waiting, ready for an inrush current. I also have the Yakogawa power meter, and I've got it ready to measure the inrush current when we start the motor. Through a fair bit of experimentation, I've kind of established that I need to set the time base for about 50 milliseconds on the Agilent. The trigger, you can see the, if you look over there, you can see the trigger level. I'm going to set that down to the same 5 amp that the other meters have been set to. So there we go, about 5 amp. I'm setting it to for a single, so I'm just pushing the single button, and now I'll start the motor. And sorry for the freehand, it's going to be the easiest way to show you what the other meters have kind of displayed. So on the Fluke, it gives kind of two periods, but you can see it, the Fluke does nicely show the kind of inrush. There's a peak inrush. I can go and set the cursor. If you look at this reading over here, that is amps peak. So as I take that in, there we go, 21.7 happens to be the peak of the inrush, which it's gone and captured. If we have a look at the Yakogawa, it's caught the inrush and it is saying it is 2.94. Now my assumption is, and perhaps I should have gone and checked the manual before, but I'm fairly certain that's an RMS reading. So we'll assume that's RMS, but what I want to show you anyway, whether that's peak or RMS, it can't be right. So that's what we want to demonstrate. So that is showing 2.94. On the HT Instruments 9022, I've gone and stopped the setting. It'll actually continue recording like the Fluke does. You can go and review. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to review the last save file. And if we have a look at there on the first screen where our inrush was, it's telling us 9 amp RMS. And I've double checked this in the manual and with them, they are picking up an RMS value, and that's what they're quoting, RMS. Now coming back to the scope, we can see the waveform or that inrush which has been captured. Over here is where we're getting that kind of peak inrush, which is the part that we're interested in. We can see how it then kind of tapers off and then goes to where it almost gets to its normal load. So what we're interested in is trying to obviously get that RMS measurement for the right period. Now there are a couple of tools which can help you do this. I can see from here that those are the two peak waveforms, and I can obviously confirm that by looking at the measurement in the display. I can then use a time base and zoom into that and then try and establish what the correct period is. Now there's a proper way of doing that, and that's obviously understanding what the period is for a 60 hertz signal, which is about 1.67 milliseconds. So I can do the adjustment over here and get that about right. The other tool you've got is that you can zoom in and frame or get a gated measurement. And it's far easier if I push the zoom button. I just have to come back out. I push the zoom button. We then get this zoomed or gated window at the top here. And if you go into your measurements, if you click on your measurements button on your oscilloscope, you've got a settings. You go into your settings and you can set where it's going to measure. And in this case, you've got three options. You've got auto select, main, and zoom. And we want the zoom, which this is the zoom window. This is the main window down below. And by using your time base window, you can see you can then change your gating. And that gives you a far easier indication along your window, because you can obviously set the offset and set where your gating is going to be. So you can get that centered in the right place.
And then all I need to do is go and set the period, which as I said is about 1.67. I'm not going to get exactly that. So there we go, 1.68. I can then use the offset to get it centered correctly. We've got our peak, and there then is our AC RMS reading, 9.179. So that reflects is what is being displayed by the HT9022. The HT9022 is just going to the amps. It doesn't have the resolution that the oscilloscope has. That certainly is near enough. Obviously the Yokogawa was way off. And on the Fluke, you saw it was that 20-odd peak, which if you double will give you about a 40 or just over 40 peak to peak, but it doesn't give you the RMS reading, which we get from the scope.
So hopefully that's given you some insight into the challenges of measuring inrush current and some of the potential issues meters can face while doing that. If I get any feedback from the manufacturers, let's say in particular Fluke, where I have a question out to them, I'll certainly come back and provide feedback on that. But if you gain any value from the video, please give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.